Okay, after worship, if you're still interested in our prayer group, come up front. We're going to pick a time for the next session. And or you've had a good time rock climbing yesterday. So be sure to get back to your seats for the video, because it is of them climbing. It was fun to watch. I'm sure, I wish I'd been there. And also, one more thing. In the back, there's a sign-up sheet for worship leaders. I don't know when you're available, so if you would just write your name next to a week that you're available, I'll remind you at that time, ahead of time, to do it, but I would like a sign-up for our worship leaders. And now I turn it over to my buddy Sue.
Had an awesome time at the indoor rock climbing, and what was really good was they did an hour of team building with the youth all together, and we had various ages. I mean, it went from JT up to Maurice, so that's not always easy to pull a group together, and they did an awesome job doing that. And then we had an hour of climbing, and you'll see, not easy. You are pulling yourself up. You're harnessed, but you need strength. So it was, they were all wonderful. So, you know, don't think, oh, that's a breeze. They're pulling them up in that harness. Oh, no. You're doing it yourself. So they did an awesome job. And we are going today from 4 to 7, the youth and parents are going swimming to Conklin Cheltenham Pool, thanks to Jenna Marina's family. And so if anybody needs any other information, you know, let me know. And we're gonna try to do a game night for the kids. I think it's the 31st of July. It's the last Monday of July. And we're gonna make it an Olympic night.
31st
of July. Okay, it's the last Monday. It's when the Olympics have already started. So it's the last Monday of July. And we're gonna make it Olympic theme, but we're gonna make every kid it's going to be Special Olympics. So they're going to need to be handicapped. So we're going to give them challenges. So it'll give them an opportunity to feel how it is for people that do the Paralympics and the Special Olympics. So it should be fun. So we'll keep you posted.
Are there any other announcements? And once again, we welcome Pastor Bob for his second week with us. And all going well so far. Please stand and greet each other to the family of God.
Him, what a beauty.
high did you get? Is it different levels, Coombe? And it was fun? Was there any kindness when you had to help each other? Yeah, there were times. All right. Nobody fell, nobody got injured, right? Okay, that's a good thing. We start there. So, did you have to work as a team? You had to work together, right? For someone that kind of you? What did you like most about it? Anybody have something like it? What is it? The rock climbing itself? Well, I love to hear when churches do such activities. I had an associate one time that she was really an athletic person, and she would pick the youth rock climbing, and they would come back exhausted. You all look really wide awake today, but I bet you were exhausted after that trip, right? Did you learn anything from rock climbing? Please. There's a pattern to it. And I'm sure that's the artist to help be safe and secure. Is there any place where you had to help each other? Where you needed somebody else to help you? Really good. For those of us who haven't rock climbed, and we wanted to do a rock climb, what would be your saying to us that we should be aware of the most? What would you want? What would you say to me? How did it come? What advice would you give? Make sure we listen to the instructor and what they say. That's good everywhere, isn't it? Thank you. And everybody safe? Nobody got hurt? That's a big plus. You want to go again? All right. Nobody's backing out for the next trip? Well, thanks for sharing that. I'll give you one more chance to say, to give us in the congregation advice about what we should look out for if we want to go rock climbing. Is it a safe thing to do? No? Yes. And is it a fun thing to do? And when you're done, you're happy you did it? Those three things are really important. I'm glad you had that opportunity, and thank you for sharing it with us. But let us pray. We give you thanks, for God, for the ability to climb hills, climb rocks. It's all about your creation. We give you thanks. So these youth who took that on to enjoy the environment, to enjoy the earth as it is, to remind us that it's not always smooth, but there's places that we have to climb. There's places that we have to help each other. We give you thanks for this experience and for these youth who dare to climb rocks together. Amen. Thank you.
There was a pastor for many years at the First United Methodist Church in Germantown, named Ted Lowden. And he was known as a great speaker, and he was known for his imagination and writing. And he wrote at least three books on prayer, and one of those books contains this prayer: "Go with me a new exodus. O God of fire and freedom, deliver me from my bondage to what can be counted, and go with me in a new exodus to towards what counts. What can only be measured in bread shared, swords become plowshares, in bodies healed, in minds liberated, in songs sung, and justice done, in laughter in the night, and joy in the morning, in love through all seasons, in great gladness of heart, in all people coming together, and a kingdom coming in glory. In your name we praise, and by becoming an hallelujah through Jesus the Christ. I invite you to share any joys or concerns you have that you want lifted up in prayer.
Yeah.
And not just prayer for this morning, but that we can take with us in our own prayer lives and hold the concerns and joys and carry them with us.
Well, I'm thankful to be back. For traveling masses. I came back over the weekend and I'm glad to be back home. I'm glad that on Tuesday I'm going to add another year to this old age of mine. I'm glad to be back in church, the fellowship with all of you. I'm glad to see that my to see all these young people getting taller and beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Nancho, it's wonderful to have you here today.
I'm thankful for a successful family reunion that we had last weekend in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm also asking for prayers for my aunt. Mary is the name. She's been in and out of hospital, and as we speak, she's in the hospital. Let's do my prayers.
Very good, thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My sister, Charlotte, is doing better, and she'll even be able to go to her son's wedding. I'm not sure exactly when it's going to take part, because it's going to be a very quiet wedding. And I also need some prayer for myself. I'm in antibiotics now for a tooth that has to come out August 22nd. Thank you for your prayer. I've had prayers for Catherine Law, who's got little loves for me. She's a man.
Good morning. If I could just have some travel mercy prayers. My husband and I will be traveling to Tennessee on vacation for a couple of weeks. And also just some prayers for myself, some serious medical conditions that come up, so just some prayers for myself.
It's prayers of joy that we have you and can do things with them. So we all need to support our youth and keep them safe through the summer.
AC got a job at the Acura dealership, so that's good. We just have to help him. He's just got to get his tools moved in. And he also, his housing application is going through. He just has to go and follow through with that. But a concern, a very dear friend of mine who was the closest thing I had to his sister, who had a lot of addiction problems, and was bipolar, lost her children, out of custody, and she lost her arm. I wasn't able to track her or anything. I knew the only way I was going to track her was the same way that what happened last night, when I did Google search and found out she passed in December. So her name was Margie, and she was a good person.
I used to go to St. John and for your prayers. I was advised by my advisor that I would get my bachelor's next year. Thanks so much.
Morning, Church. I am sure that I am thankful that I was able to meet my family last night and have a beautiful family reunion after 5 years of hiatus. It's usually an annual event, but because of COVID, it was fixed for several years. So we all had a great time, and thanks for traveling, Mercy.
Morning, Church. Just a couple of things. We're thankful for my brother who will be celebrating his 40th birthday. July 30th. So we just thank God for him celebrating another year. I'm also asking for prayers for my husband's business, that God continues to guide him and show him open doors for him with that. And just prayers for the kids and the upcoming school year.
I'm asking for a prayer for my country, Sierra Leone, my culture of origin, Sierra Leone. Although this is the rainy season, we have an unusual heavy downpour of rain for this period, and half of it. City is underwater, and for a country that is struggling, it is important for people. Half of the city is underwater. So let's remember and pray for those that are affected. Thank you.
Pastor Randy called me this morning. He got a call from Damien Cunningham, who was from Frankfort Memorial Church. He's asking for prayers because he has some serious medical tests coming up. So we want to keep Damien Cunningham in our prayers.
Thank you for sharing those thoughts and concerns. Let us open our hearts in prayer. For God, we care for one another. And that's what we did in looking up the names and concerns and worries about ourselves and about others. From individuals to nations. So much, oh God, that we can't control. But what we do have is the gift of worship and the gift of prayer and the gift of community and the gift of caring for one another and sharing that care with others in the congregation. We have lifted up prayers of healing, prayers of grief, for one who has died. We pray that you receive him into the arms of your mercy and raise him up with all your saints. We give you thanks that we can turn to you in prayer with burdens and joys, with burdens, and you help us carry them and address them and live with them. And hope that, and pray that things change for the good. And we open our hearts to you in prayer. When things don't go our way, may we not blame you, but may we recognize that as part of life, life in you. Sometimes we get saved, but in all things we know that you accompany us on this journey. And that you're with us in spirit in all that we face. We give you thanks for the compassion shared in praying for others. And in this moment, O God, the prayer is what we lift up. Because we feel so powerless about what we can change or can't change. But with prayer, O God, we release our burdens, knowing that you carry them
with us and even for us. It's such a gift of peace that we can turn to you in times of joy and times of sorrow, in times of health and in times of sickness, in times of life and in times of death. Oh God, we thank you for the courage to share what we shared for this prayer this morning. And we pray that we carry those names, we carry those concerns with us, and not just hold them this day in our prayer, but carry the joys and the concerns that have been shared with us in our own prayer life. What a God you are, to take on and listen, hear all that we have to lift up to you, and all that we have to learn from you. May your Spirit be the healing Spirit, comforting Spirit, and the Spirit of worship this morning. We give you thanks. Amen.
Thank you.
for these gifts that are presented to you. It represents more than what's in this plate. It represents the giving of ourselves for the work of your kingdom, to the witness of your peace, to the grace of your love, to the building of your unity, to the seeking for justice, to caring for one another. We receive these gifts of God and the generosity that they are offered, and that they will make a difference in our lives and the life of this congregation. We pray in Jesus' name, the one who gave his life for the life of the world. Amen.
For him is be still my soul. Carpenter, the son of Mary, and a brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and were not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing with their journey, except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you, and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust and that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is a reading of the Gospel. Thanks for being here. I love the way the Bible talks about Jesus. It talks about us, the people. The first part of this reading is being with Jesus in his hometown of Nazareth, where he was well known. And on this Sabbath, he began teach. Whatever he said must have been astounding. The crowds wondered where he got this wisdom and noticed the deeds of his power as it was being done with his hands. They wondered if this was Mary's son, that little boy they watched grow up. Growth is all about change. I remember writing a letter to my near the end of my college years, to my mother. I told her what I was up to and shared stories of what in my faith I see differently. Whatever I said in my letter, I don't remember everything I did say, I was inspired by my mother to send her thoughts in response. Her letter shared her feeling by asking, I wonder if the son who is graduating from college is the same son that I sent to college. I could hear the hurt in her words. I showed my letter to my religion professor, who is also a friend of my pastor at my home church in Lebanon. They went to seminary. And this was where my mother happened to be, the church where my mother happened to be the secretary. This means my mother was secretary to my home minister, who was a friend of my college religion professor. I showed this letter from my mother to Dr. Newfer. He took my mother's letter, looked up at me, and said, here is your mother, concerned about her sons being changed in college, and me, Professor Newfer, sending my daughter off to college, hoping it will be a changing experience for her. This reading tells us that Jesus was open to the Holy Spirit and whatever change is brought to him. Whatever change is brought to Jesus. So the crowds asked, is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary? The question indicates something happened. Something changed in Jesus. They're questioning if this isn't the same person they saw grow up in Nazareth, in their hometown. As an itinerant United Methodist minister, I have experienced physical changes, like moving from one parsonage to another. I began my ministry as a single pastor in an apartment in West Virginia. And I retired as a single minister in a rental house in Mount Airy, Philadelphia. It is these moves that I relate to in the second part of the scripture reading, the mission of the 12. What Jesus did with their questions was what Jesus would always do. He sent his disciples out to witness to God's love and Jesus' teachings. And he sent his disciples out two by two. They could only take a staff, but no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. Very sparse things to carry. My confession is, my mission took me in the opposite direction. The last time I traveled late was the year I was a VISTA volunteer in Brooklyn, New York, with 9 other people living in our rent house. It took 10 people to afford the monthly rent. I shared a room with one other person, and the other 9 had their places to stay. I remember it was a big deal to get a turntable for my stereo system. Being in a room that I only had half the room, clothes, books or two, stereo, a TV, and a radio. Today, travel encourages us to travel late. You have to pay for luggage. So instead of dropping it off at the counter, picking it up at your destination, we have to carry luggage on the plane, put one piece in over there in the overheads, and then put a handbag under the seat in front of us to save money. This morning, I want to witness to you how this text has been playing out in my life, and specifically in my being appointed to this church. For the 10 years before I moved for the 10 years before coming here, I moved to Yardley, Bucks County, where I lived in a rancher with a family room, a kitchen, an area for a kitchen table, dining room, living room, 3 bedrooms, 2.5 baths, study with shelves floor to ceiling, closet, filing cabinets, and below this was a basement of an equal area as the upstairs for storage. There was also a 2-car garage under a porch that extended from the living room upstairs. So here's the tension. We had moved 2 vans full of stuff into the house 10 years before. There was a lot of stuff. Then I had the opportunity to attend a courage and renewal retreat. The emphasis of the retreat was on the message that comes in the fall, when the trees let go of their leaves. I focused on what I had to let go of to make space in my life. The next retreat, we checked in about where we stood with our goals. I reported with a heavy heart that I had not made any movement toward my downsizing my life and the clutter in it. That's a confession. The next retreat, we checked in about where we stood, and I reported with a heavy heart. When I learned that I was appointed to the First United Methodist Church of Germany, all I could think about and all my energy was suddenly focused on downsizing, getting rid of stuff, making ready to move into a place, a house, or an apartment. Coombe had no parsonage, but they had a house in Dallas. So I found a house in Mount Airy, where I am renting and have been living since 2015. I've been thinking about this scripture that begins with Jesus being rejected in his hometown, in the synagogue, and in the community. Jesus knows where he is not wanted. He moves through the towns and villages. He gathers his disciples and sends them out in twos, with no money, no purse, and no reserves. All they took was a staff, sandals, and less than two thin tunics. That means one tunic. They were dependent on the hospitality, or in some cases, the inhospitality, shown toward them. They were open and receptive to the people and their mission. Their purpose was to be disciples of Jesus' love. Jesus gave them the power and the authority to cast out demons and anoint and cure the sick. I'm emphasizing Jesus' need to cure the sick. They traveled light so that they could focus on their mission, giving new life and authority to cast out the demons. A new life so that it will focus on their mission and giving new life, healing, and hope that they share with people along the way. During this time of transition for me, a dear friend kept getting sicker and sicker from a diseased liver, for which he was waiting a donor so he could have a transplant and live. This is a friend who we met the first night in Boy Scouts when we were 13 years old. And what was going on during this time of transition with my son, my friend, waiting for a loop? 9 young black children were shot and killed by a policeman. A man entered Mother Emanuel A&E Church in Charlestown, South Carolina, and opened fire in the middle of a prayer service, killing 8 people. But the weight of stuff in a time of change was draining more of my energy and my witness. 40 years of sermons and bulletins were thrown into the paper recycling bin, a yard sale, and to goodwill. I am still needing to downsize, but now I have a reason to make this part of my living. When the disciples traveled light, they had an impact on the people. Oh, how you can yearn for the power that Jesus gave them, not to control or dominate, but to cast out demons, to heal, to love, to accept. That's what Jesus cares about. How we live, not what we have. We can risk traveling light for this reason, the reason of a better life, a transformed life. And this is not a new day because you have a new pastor. This is not a new day for me because I'm appointed here. The new day will come when we embrace the new thing that God is doing within us and through us. I invite us to address all this stuff in our lives and give ourselves to the reason we are a church, to address the demons that seek to claim our lives and the lives of our communities. The blessing to travel late is not just to save the $25 baggage fee at the airport, but to lighten the load, to do the heavy work of sharing God's love and hospitality in an inhospitable world. To witness to the beauty and life-giving God-giving creation of God and God's Spirit in a world that is never satisfied with what it has. So what we take on our journey, this journey, is not the things we have around us, but what we have within us. The outside and the inside come together in community. Are we not disciples of Jesus? Disciples of God's love, walking together in this world that would greatly benefit from love and the way for peace? All we need to do with that peace is travel light. And no matter how light we are, we have Jesus' love within us. We have Jesus' grace to witness to. And we have Jesus' peace to proclaim. It doesn't take a lot of things to do that. It takes faithfulness for the journey so we can travel light as the disciples did. And look what they did. They changed the world. We are here because of the disciples. The disciples that Jesus called then, and the disciples of Jesus has been sending since then. Friends, that includes us. We are the disciples of Jesus in today's world. And what are we carrying? I'm not so worried about the physical things we carry. I failed in that. But the love of God we carry. The grace of God we carry. The peace of God we carry. Because that's what Jesus gave us, to which to witness. And it's always a good journey to make when we know we're following Jesus. It might be harder for us to travel light, but the light of God's love shines in and through us. And that's what makes the difference. Thanks be to God. Please stand, and this is our last hymn, our affirmation of faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. I believe Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven.
To serve humanity, to make our thoughts and actions less prone to please the crowd, to stand with humble courage for truth with hearts uncowed. We marvel at the purpose that held thee to thy course, while ever on the hilltop before thee loomed the cross. Thy steadfast face set forward, where love and beauty shone, while we betray so quickly and leave thee there alone. Oh, help us stand unswerving against war's bloody way, where hate and lust and falsehood hold back Christ's holy sway. Forbid false love of country that blinds us to his call, who lifts above the nations the unity of all. Stir up in us a protest against our greed for wealth, while others starve and hunger and plead for work and help, where homes with little children cry out for lack of bread, who lives their years sore burdened beneath a gloomy dread.
The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in that peace, embraced by God's love, with the courage of the disciples. Amen.
Young and fearless prophet, we need thy presence here. Amid our pride and glory, to see thy face appear. Once more to hear thy challenge above our noisy day, again to lead us forth.